God's house. So glad you're here. Last Sunday was an awesome message, wasn't it? I didn't believe that it was going to come out like it came out. When he said, I'm going to stay on the book of Revelation, and I said, well, it's Mother's Day. And he said, God told me to stay right on target. And I go, oh, God. But you know, it's one of the most interesting messages, and I text Pastor. You know, he does need occasionally texts of encouragement to let people know how blessed they were. And at the close, I said, that's one of the best Mother's Day sermons I've ever heard from the book of Revelation. My goodness, like, wow. Well, we're so glad you're here today, and we know that you will be blessed. And God is wanting to do something. Mark, you did a superb job in teaching this morning. And I was thinking as you were ministering, and then other people commented about, you know, there's times and seasons in our life where even Daniel was commenting about that he became exhausted regarding doing God's will and fighting the enemy. And I believe that the enemy would like to destroy on us the cares of this world. And then what happens when that occurs, we forget the dream. And the dream slowly that God birthed in your spirit, you knew that you knew at an altar or in your home. You knew that God was going to bring it to pass. But because of the cares of the world, it sets into your life and the dream becomes only a dream. A dear brother that was very strong in Youth with a Mission, and everyone that is with that group knows who he is. I won't mention his name, but he was in, I believe, Nicaragua, and he was a young pastor there. And before he came to the mainland of the United States, and as he was out doing his daily chores one day, visiting people, knocking on doors, and he said he dropped by the nursing home, and this was where a lot of people were very aged and sick, and they said, we have a new person in the nursing home, and the lady that was in charge said, I want you to see her. And so he said, I walked in, and he said, I was very accustomed to just to simply pray with people and ask God to deliver them. But he said, that morning God birthed. Has God ever birthed in your spirit a definite, not maybe, but a definite, that you know that you're supposed to hold onto God's unchanging hand and trust him for what he has promised, that the dream then turns into a vision, and the vision brings to fruition. And he said, I walked in, and the lady actually had to be elevated, lifted up in a wheelchair. And he said, she lost all of her faculties. She couldn't speak. She could hear, but she couldn't talk. And she'd been there about 3 weeks, and she was in her late 20s. And he said, I just said, Father, in the name of Jesus Christ, you know, in the name of Jesus, demons tremble. Did you know the Word of God says that? And he said, I started to walk away. And he said, Pastor, I turned back around, and I looked at her in the pathetic state that she was in, a wasted life at 25 years of age. And he said, I just went over, and he said, it was God, because it certainly wasn't me. And he said, I whispered in her ear where no one else could hear. He said, God is going to really heal you. He's going to heal you. She couldn't even move her head. And he said, I'll pray every day for you. And he said, I lived about a mile and a half from the nursing home. And he said, I would go in expecting God. What are you expecting from God? What are you wanting from God? Well, I prayed 2 weeks ago, but it didn't happen. And so I more or less put it on the back burner. That's so sad. If God has birthed something in your spirit, let it remain on the front burner. So he said, the Holy Spirit instructed me and said, pray, I promise you, you pray until. And then he said, the longest tenure of prayer I ever experienced in my life, to pray over one particular thing, 5 years. And he said, I live close to the facility, and I would walk in, and I would say, God's going to heal you today. Now, don't misunderstand me. God doesn't always heal the way we want him to. But he felt so impressed that this was going to occur. He said one night he received a phone call. 5 years. And they said, you got to come up to the nursing home. He said, they didn't tell me why. But he said, I came up to the nursing home and I walked in and they said, here she is. And she was standing and she could talk in clarity and was completely made whole after 5 years, not 1 month. That's where we throw in the proverbial towel. Remember what the word says, the vision is for an appointed time. It will not tarry. And it will not be a single moment late. What is God's vision for you today? Pastor, I'm praying for you. I know you prayed all week that God would give you the right words. Can I have the privilege of offering prayer with you right now from the left to the right? Not because I'm anything, but I'm a representer of him. His name is Jesus. Father, I love you. And every person in this building are precious to you. And they've come from a very, very busy world. Lord, so many cares, and they're just heaped upon them. And some of them are weary and tired. And then all of a sudden, their dreams and their hopes and their plans die. And Satan says, I'll see to it that it occurs. But today, would your Holy Spirit settle in upon this congregation? And Lord, reinstill that vision that you birthed in their life last month, last year, 2 years ago. You knew that you knew then, and you know that it's real now. And Lord, at the end of this service, we can say, oh, victory in Jesus, my Savior forever. Amen and amen. And all of God's children said amen. Amen. Let's have church. Thank the Lord.
Stand with me, church. Let's sing to the Lord. I'll worship the King. Oh, worship the King, all glorious above, and gratefully sing his wonderful love. Our shield and defender, the Ancient of Days, brilliant in splendor and girded with praise. Tell of his might, oh, sing of his grace, whose robe is the light, whose canopy space. His chariots of wrath, the deep thunder clouds form, dark is his path on the of the storm. You alone are the matchless King. To you alone be all majesty. Your glories and wonders what tongue can recite. You breathe in the air. You shine in the light. Above, thy mercies, how tender, how firm to the end, our Maker, Defender, Redeemer, and Friend. You alone are the matchless King, to you alone be all majesty. Your glories and wonders, what tongue can recite? You breathe in the air. Shine in the light. You alone are the matchless King. To you alone be all majesty. Your glories and wonders, what tongue can recite? You breathe in the air. You shine in the light. You shine in the light. Shine. voice above and gratefully sing His wonderful love. Our shield and defender, the Ancient of Days, pavilioned in splendor and girded with
God that we can praise this morning. You know, there's a lot of junk going on in this world right now, a lot of stuff that we don't like. And our first thing, our first place that we run to is fear. We get scared because the world is uncertain. We don't know what's next. But when you stand in God's love, when you stand in God's love, there's no fear. Doesn't stand a chance. So let's sing it to the Lord this morning. Amen. When darkness tries to roll over my bones, when sorrow comes to steal the joy I all I know, I won't be shaken. No, I won't be shaken. 'Cause my fear doesn't stand a chance when I stand in your love. My fear doesn't stand a chance when I stand in your love. My fear doesn't stand a chance when I stand in your love.
Standing in your
see is the mountain. You see a mountain. And as I walk through the shadows, your love surrounds me. There's nothing to fear now, for I am safe with you. So when I fight, I'll fight on my knees, with my hands lifted high. Oh God, the battle belongs to you. Every fear I lay at your feet, I'll sing through the night. To share in our missions next week. But this morning, we are very, I guess, happy in some ways that, you know, the Lord has, three of our young folks has graduated, and they'll come up here in a moment, and John will introduce those to you. But when I was thinking about this morning, thinking about them graduating from high school and going on to college and then going on into the career that God put them in, you know, this is an important time for them. And I just want to say, we're praying for you guys to stay close to the Lord, stay in church, and be filled with the power of God. Because I'm going to tell you, going out in the world that you're about to go out in, and I know that Lance had to mention that while ago, I was doing good until he mentioned that.
Sometimes we can be bummed out in this world. But anyway, I pray for you. I pray for you guys that you would do that. But I want to give a shout out to Brandy Corbo. She graduated college as well. So give her a shout out for that. But John, if you would, come on up here and introduce us to these guys and gals. And, you know, once again, the church is praying for you guys. Stay close to the Lord. Go ahead.
James, Madison, Jake, will you come up here? This is a... Can everybody hear me? All right. This is a bittersweet moment for me as your youth pastor here at Grace because these three individuals were incoming freshmen when I first started here. And it is a little bit more bittersweet because one of these graduates is my son. And so I just am so thankful to have you guys here. These are amazing young men and women who love the Lord. I've watched them grow up in their faith. I've watched the boldness that they've taken going into their schools and homes. And guys, I just want to give you some words of advice that were given to me when I was your age by my pastor. Know who you are and whose you are. And what he meant by that was know who you are in Christ and whose you are. Because of your faith, because you've received Jesus, you have the right to be called a child of God.
Amen.
You are God's child. Amen. So as you start this next chapter in life and this journey, wherever the Lord takes you, know who you are and whose you are. Therefore, walk boldly, as the psalmist says, as a lion. Pastor, will you come pray? Bless
yeah.
them.
Yeah.
And Madison.
Amen.
Father, we come before you today, and Lord, we just want to thank you. Praise you, Lord, for these young men and young women. Father, as they lead their life off into, Lord, into this world, and I know that, Lord, you'll be with them. And Father, I pray that the Holy Spirit would go with them, would lead them, guide them. Lord, keep their faith strong. Lord, we pray that they would always turn to you, always grow in their faith. And so, Father, they need it today. We all need it today. But, Lord Jesus, I do pray your blessings upon them. Thank you, Lord, for what you blessed them with already, but the blessings that's coming in the future for them as well. And Father, I know that you're going to go with them and take care of them. Your word teaches that you never leave us nor forsake us. Your word tells us, Lord, you're always there. Just at a moment of the heart's need, Lord, that you're there. And so, Father, I praise you and thank you for what you're going to do with them. Now, as we have been here lately, Lord, recognizing missionaries, Father, you send us all into the world to be that, Lord, and to share our faith with the people. So I pray for that as well, Lord, that you'd open doors for them. We pray it all in Christ's name. Amen.
Amen.
Thank you, brother.
We have some gifts for you guys.
To be graduating from high school and starting that time of life. Some of us praise the Lord, and others go, I'm glad I've not been there and done that. But anyway, it's really nice. I want to, before the ushers come this morning, I want to remind you that, as I said earlier, everything that's taken here at Grace Fellowship and tithes, we try to give 10% of that back into missions. And we pour it into missions, and there are several that we support. There's if you ever want to know who those are, there's a spreadsheet there on the South Foyer. You can look up and see what we give and how many we support. But, you know, as I was praying for them, I was thinking, well, I don't know where they're going to go. They may go to different colleges. Who knows where they're going? God knows. But you know what? They're Christians. They love the Lord. And wherever Christians go that love the Lord, it's a field of opportunity. You don't know who you'll be in front of, folks. And you may, as yesterday, me and my wife went to grab a quick supper, and the lady, when she served us the food, I seen Jesus written tattooed on her wrist. And I asked her, and she was a Chinese from the nationality, and she had met the Lord 8 years ago, I believe it was. And she is new in her faith. But she's willing to express that faith, even with a simple tattoo. And so when I say we got an open door, we got an open door. There's plenty of people out there that need to hear about Jesus. You just take it for granted all of them have heard about Jesus. But that's not so. There's a field of them that need to hear. So I encourage you to do that. I encourage our guys and gals as they go that they'll do that. But this morning, I'm going to ask the ushers to come as we take up this morning's offering. And let's pray and let's ask the Lord to the amount we should give. And if there's any young folks here who would love to help me take up the change offering, I'd like to invite you to come up as well. And we'll take up the change offering. And every offering that we give here goes to help out people in our church, outside of our church, and everywhere else. So may God bless you for coming and giving. Father, we just thank you for this wonderful day that we have. And Lord, we praise you today. And Lord, I just want to get my heart ready, Lord, here to give. And Father, you know what I should give, the amount I should give. Lord, you determine that in the heart. And Father, I pray that I'd be a cheerful giver. I pray, Lord, that I'd worship you this way. We love you, as said already this morning. We love you. And so, Lord, we want to express that love toward you. So, Father, take what's given here this morning and use it in your kingdom for your glory. In Christ's name, amen.
On water, and you calm the raging seas. You command the highest mountains to fall upon their knees. You're the one who welcomes sinners, and you open blinded eyes. You restore the brokenhearted, and you brought the dead to life. Forgetting all our sins, you remember all your promises. You are amazing, more than amazing. Forever. Set the captive free. You're the King who came to serve, and you're the God who washed our feet. You're the one who took our burdens, and you bled upon the cross. In your kindness and your mercy, you became the way for us. Forgetting all our sins, amazing, more than amazing.
Praise the Lord. How many of you brought your Bibles to church, your paper Bible? Got it? Good. I hope you read from it. I hope you study it. Now, I know that some look at the Word on their phones or their electronic device. It's just not the same as the pages turning. But that's okay as long as you're looking at the Word of God. The reason why I say that is because you ought to always read and study the passage that whomever's speaking to you, be it a pastor or someone else that's sharing from the Word of God, what it says, so you can verify it. Because preachers have a tendency to preach fast, and sometimes they say things that are not exactly in the Word of God. Like last week, I think it was, I said, we'll get to chapters 21, 22, and 23. Well, if you notice in Revelation, there's no chapter 23. But you know, I was doing that optimistically. Because we're going to be experiencing chapter 23 on the other side. But anyway, sometimes we say things that are not exactly accurate with Scripture, and we'd like for you to make sure that you're reading the Word and that you're studying as well, reading along with us. So turn your Bibles over to chapter 21, my favorite two chapters of Revelation, 21 and 22. I need to tell you something here. This particular part I'm reading you this morning is a powerful passage of Scripture. It's millions and millions of people have been blessed just hearing it. It's been quoted in movies, it's been spoken at bedsides, and songs and hymns have been written about it. But if you ever go to a memorial that I'm at, and it's a passing of a saint, I'll always read chapter 21 of Revelation, because it is very comforting. Let me read this to you this morning, and then we'll discuss what the Lord has put on our heart. Now I saw a new heaven and a new earth, for the first heaven and the first earth had passed away. Also there was no more sea. Then I, John, the Apostle John, saw the holy city, New Jerusalem, coming down out of heaven from God, prepared as a bride adorned for her husband. And I heard a loud voice from heaven saying, Behold, the tabernacle of God is with men, and he will dwell with them, and they shall be his people. You ought to get real encouraged right there. God himself will be with them and be their God, and God will wipe away every tear from their eyes. There shall be no more death, nor sorrow, nor crying. There shall be no more pain, for the former things have passed away. Then he who sat on the throne said, Behold, I make all things new. And he said to me, Write these words that are true and faithful. And he said to me, It is done. I am the Alpha and the Omega, the beginning and the end. I will give the fountain of the water of life freely to him who thirsts. He who overcomes shall inherit all things, and I will be his God, and he shall be my son. Now, verse 8 or 9 there, my glasses 8, goes on to talk about those who won't be there because they rejected God. But I wanted to share that with you this morning to tell you this. This is probably, out of the entire book of Revelation, probably the entire Bible, this is the verse that just is amazing. And it comforts my heart. It blesses me every time I read it. And I think about it and try to comprehend in my mind what it's going to be like to be with God in the new city of Jerusalem. And we'll get to that. I think for this very reason, everyone that reads this particular passage is comforted and blessed to know that God keeps his promises. You just got through singing a song that talked about God keeping his promises. I shared with you last week on Mother's Day that my mother passed away in 1988. My wife had the privilege to leading her to Christ 7 days before she passed away. And during that 7 days that she was a Christian here on the earth, still in the hospital, all I could think about was when she gets out of the hospital, she's going to come down there and probably go to church with me, and boy, this is going to be a real challenge. Because my mother was one of those that God had to transform, if you know what I mean. All of us have been transformed. But she was very open-minded, would say, just tell you what she thought, be it good or be it bad. And so I was thinking, I'm going to be serving the Lord with her, going to church with her, and I'm going to be putting out some fires. Until she grew in Christ. You know, that's what we do. We get saved and we grow in Christ and we grow out of all that. But I was looking forward to that. And then 7 days later, she passed. And this particular scripture was reminded. I was reminded of this particular scripture. And what God has done, even though she was only here 7 short days, she will be here in this particular passage forevermore. And so will you if you're in Christ Jesus today. The book of Revelation that God gave to John to write through visions and him being called up to heaven and God speaking to him through the voice of God and through the angels is certainly a powerful book, but most of it talks about God's judgment that's coming upon the earth. It starts off talking to the church about getting your act together. Basically what it means, get your act together and all this and let's serve God. But most of it's judgment, but you get to the end of it. And then God brings out his promises to those that are his, those that are in Christ Jesus. And that promise, folks, has got to be the biggest to me. And so when the early church was reading this account of John, and about the will of God, the book of Revelation is the bookend of the entire scriptures. It's the last book. Matter of fact, when we get to chapter 22, some of the last words John says is, Jesus, come quickly. We're at the end. He gives you full revelation. So it's the bookend on that end. And the bookend on the other end is Genesis, which we'll be getting to when we finish Revelation. So you'll have the entire story, God's story, and his love for man, and all wrapped up between them two books. So here we go. When he says, I saw a new heaven and a new earth, if you like this place that you're on now, you're in trouble. Because it will be burned up and destroyed. God's making a new earth and a new heaven. Do you believe the word of God? That's what it says there. A new earth, a new heaven. The first earth passed away. And there is no longer any sea for all of you that like to go to the sea. Oh, man, I'm going to miss the sea. Well, this is symbolic to, in many ways, of what the people experienced in those days in biblical times. They related the sea as a place of chaos. And so every time they wrote about chaos, they'd write about the raging sea. And so just for it to say no more sea, there'll be no more chaos, there'll be no more trouble, there'll be no more problems. Remember, I'm wiping all those away. And so, I know all of you like new things. How many people like new things in here? Come on. No, I want an old thing. I want a used thing. I want a wore out thing. No, you want a new thing. And you know what? If you're like most of these Texans, you'll get to a point where you want a new house or a new car, something like that. And sometimes it can be an old car, but it's new to you. But you're wanting a brand new when it comes with a warranty. So when it breaks, you can carry it back, get it fixed again, or get it replaced. Well, let me tell you what. God's making something that will not wear out, that will not fade, will not break, and it's a place for you. It's a place for you. And what must I do to inherit this? When Matthew chapter 10, Jesus says this, and he who does not take up his cross and follow me is not worthy of me. Now let me tell you something here. We ought to take up the cross of Christ and follow him. This is what God's will for our life is. He who finds his life will lose it. He who loses his life for my sake will find it. So it's going to cost you. When you give your life to Christ, you know what's going to happen? Your old person is going to fade away. Your old life is passing away. And God makes something new of you. You said you like new things. Do you like new creation? Because that's what God does with you. And so that's what I said while ago. When you become a Christian, it takes a little while for God to trim all the rough edges. Did you have rough edges when you come into the kingdom of God? Do you have wild shoots today that need to be trimmed? You do. And God's still doing that. So, but John's speaking of something here that is, folks, I don't believe any of us here can wrap our mind around. This is amazing. New earth, new heaven. Because see, to John, when he looked out, he saw the skies. And he could see at night the stars. So in a particular time when he would be writing something, he said, I saw a new heavens and a new earth. He'd see it. A new heavens and a new earth literally meaning that this one, he might see this heaven meaning the sky and the secondary heaven meaning the stars. And we know that Paul wrote about the third heaven, meaning where God's at. And then you notice it says in those scriptures, this city coming down. That's why we always look up when we're talking about God. We always look up. I don't know if it's a three-dimension where he just pulls back the curtain and he shows up. I don't believe so. I believe it's just like John says, it's going to come down out of heaven from God. So he said he saw this holy city coming down from God. Let me ask you a question. Everything, the Bible says every good thing comes from where? Above, from God. Is that not true? I mean, let's just look at it a moment. When God came to you and spoke to you and told you, like he told me, you're a sinner, you need to be saved. You realize you were a sinner. God spoke to your heart and then you accepted God. And when you accepted God, let me ask you a question. How good did it feel? Come on. How good did it feel to know that you have been forgiven of your sin? Somebody tell me. It deserves a hallelujah. It really does. Of what God has done in your life. That's good. What God done. You know, I wish I had sometimes faith like Abraham. When he was called to go out to a place in which he would receive as an inheritance, he went out. God said, go west or go east, young man, and he went. Knowing that where he was going, by faith, he dwelt in the land of promise as in a foreign country, dwelling in tents, with Isaac and Jacob. He knew that this place was not his home. This is what he said. The heirs with him of the same promise, for he waited for a city which has foundations whose builder and maker is God. He said that way back. It's amazing how God confirms all of this in the scriptures. So John writes about this dwelling place of God coming down out of heaven. And we're going to get into that in more detail next week, Lord willing, the holy city of Jerusalem. But just to give you a little bit of an idea of what God has designed and what God has built with his own hands that's coming down. This city is known to be 1,500 miles high, 1,500 miles wide. Y'all know how far 1,500 miles is? Drive from here to California, you get a pretty good feel, maybe. If you drive here to Oregon, you might get a better one. 1,500 miles wide, 1,500 miles high. Did you know how high Mount Everest is? Anybody here that done their history? It's approximately 6 miles high. This is 1,494 miles higher, 250 times bigger. So that gives you a little bit of an idea. What God has made for man is coming down from heaven. When John writes about this place, he writes about it as if it were a bride. Now we're going to get into the mystery of God. Ephesians teaches us that we're the church. Ephesians teaches us that Christ is the groom. Ephesians teaches us we shall be married. This is a great mystery. So we'll be in the presence of God? You mean there's going to be this relationship between God and humanity as a wedding? You mean it's going to be in a wedding form? How many of you like weddings? Excuse me. Be truthful. How many of you like weddings? We all like weddings. Matter of fact, you were probably at one. If you got a spouse here today, you were at one of those. Uniting the hearts, combining the lives, do you find it surprising that God's relating an eternal relationship to a wedding or a marriage? Marriage is a promise. If you didn't know it, when you were standing there before that preacher some 50 years ago, for some of you, you said, no matter what happens, I'm paraphrasing, I'll love her and I'll promise to keep her till the day I die. That's a big promise. Now, John says there was a loud voice. Now dwelling, the dwelling of God is with men. The tabernacle of God is with men. He will live with them. They will be his people. And he will be their God. So, when you said, I do, go back to that wedding just for a moment. When you said, I do, I heard a guy say one time at a wedding, he said, look, you can right before you get married, you can back out right now. Before you get up there and say, I do, you can back out and it'll be okay. But once you say, I do, it's going to take a lawyer and a bunch of money to get you out of there. Well, you shouldn't marry somebody that you're already having a question about. Because if you love an individual, this is a relationship, folks. You love an individual and you say, I do. That relationship, as far as I can remember, said, through sickness and health, rich or poor, till death do you part. Now God, if he's relating his relationship to us as that of a marriage, he says this, the former things have passed away. Behold, all things become new. I will be your God and you will be my people. And that's a promise God has made. And there's no death do you part. It's forever. Y'all realize how long is forever? Somebody tell me. Forever. You can't get your mind wrapped around that, much less the rest of this. I will be his son. I will be his child forever?
Yes, you will be.
When you understand God's love, when he said in Ephesians, I will just read and refresh my mind on that just earlier, when Jesus said that he gave his life for the church. You know, there's no greater love than a man lay down his life for another. And so here's where God had laid down his life for us. He has done that. Now, he's going to wipe away every tear from your eyes. You ever had any tears? Now, there's tears of happiness and tears of sadness. And, you know, there's been times, and I've got to tell you, there's been times when I've seen people that I love or when I've seen people that I just come to know recently receive Christ, and the tears of happiness flow. I'm rejoicing with them. But then there's those tears of sadness that happen. Y'all know what I mean. When you lose someone that you love, those tears of sadness come. God will wipe away all of those. And you know what? I need to say something here. When it comes to tears of sadness, most of the time the only ones in this world that can do us any good other than God be the first, is a dear friend or a spouse that can help us get through those hard times. So something entirely new, he says. I'm going to make a new heaven, a new earth. And now, those things will be no more. Gone. You know, we talk about many times in here about the new world order and about the old order of things, but God's making a new one in this new order of things. How can he do that? He has the authority to do that. He is God. Don't forget this now. If I just tell you, look, somebody told me, let's go back to that wedding thing. Somebody told me, said, they asked me one time, what's your record? In other words, when I married people, how many of them stayed together, how many of them divorced? They wanted a preacher with a good record. It's not up to me. I don't know where you got that from, but it's not up to me. It's out between you two and God. And I have to throw God in there because if you don't have God, you two ain't going to make it. So, here we go. He who sat on the throne, I am making everything new. Then he said, write this down. Now, I'm going to tell you, when I heard that phrase, I couldn't help but think, you get a song in your head, and so you get good songs and bad songs, and I'm going to tell you, you get bad songs by listening to the wrong music. But George Strait sung a song. Y'all all can relate to this. Now, that song, not entirely bad, the one I mentioned. Matter of fact, some of you Christians in here love music. You could reword that and put God here and take some things out, and it might be a pretty good song to sing at that point. Write this down. Take my words and read them every day. Keep them close by. Don't let them fade away. That line is pretty good. And what we need to do in our world today is we need to read the Word of God, and we need to write the Word of God, and what we need to do is to remember the Word of God and don't let it fade away. Right? Not all that bad. So write this down. You know, it's kind of like, he's telling John, write this down. That's the authority God can do. It is done. I am the Alpha and the Omega, the beginning and the end. To him who is thirsty, I will give drink without cost from the well of from the water of, I messed that up, didn't I? From the spring of the water of life. That was a different translation, so kind of got off a little bit there. But that's what God does. This is all about God, what I'm talking about this morning. This is all about God. This is not about you. You're a part of it. This is all about God. It's all about his love. It's all about him making everything new. It's all about him being the almighty God in your life. It's not the church. This is the eternal one right now. This is the everlasting one, the creator, the maker of heaven and earth. To whom is he compared? Is there anyone that can compare to him? No. His glory, his beauty. The one who is, by his very definition, all-consuming and everlasting love. That's the one writing this to you. That's what he's saying to you. So this makes this passage so comfortable and encouraging. The one who sent his only son into the world, because knowing there's a great gulf between God and humanity, he was willing to do everything it took, even sending his son down the cross so that he could have a relationship with you. He loves you. And when people have said this all the time, I've heard this, well, if God loved me, he wouldn't really send me to hell. Well, let me tell you something. God loves you. That statement is true. But he don't send you to hell. You send you to hell. So people need, people need to get that right. The only way that you're going to end up in hell is because you rejected Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior. And he's offered himself to you time and time again. I'd heard someone say the other day, how many times has God offered himself? Or how many times has God come? How many times has God plead with you? I don't know the answer to that. I don't know. But I know he at least come once. And that's why the scriptures say today's the day. If he comes knocking, you don't wait. You let God do his business in your heart. So he sent his son. He's done everything there was to do. And let me tell you this, according to scripture. He invites us, all humanity, the whosoever will, as one of the scriptures teaches. I'm having this wedding banquet. Go out into the streets and say, whoever wants to come can come. You're the whosoever will. Now let me tell you something about this wedding banquet that's going to take place. Let me tell you something about this New Jerusalem coming down that we just read about in 21. The invitations have went out. They went out. It's through the word of God. The invitations have went out. You either receive one in your life before this time, or maybe today you're receiving it for the first time. But the invitation has went out. The dates have been set by the Father. The dates have been set. And let me tell you what, according to the Bible, the groom is coming. And he's coming for his bride. And who is his bride? Church. You are. The church. The only question that remains here today to be answered, will you be there? That's it. Will you be there? You know, when you're invited to the wedding and you go, you witness a love between a man and a woman. I'm old-fashioned, I'm going to leave it there. You witness love between a man and a woman. You witness what God says, the two becoming one. And why God related this to a wedding is still a mystery. But you're witnessing at this particular banquet, you becoming God's child. You becoming God's bride. When you want to be at that one? Wouldn't you want to be there? So I'm asking you this morning, you know, I believe the invitation to me to come into the kingdom of God, and you know my story, it happened 3 Sundays in a row. God figured I better not, for some reason, he's so grateful. Every time I come to the church, I heard the message, and I had to do something with it. And you know what? I shake in my boots sometimes because that first 2 Sundays I rejected it. I didn't come to Christ. That third Sunday when he said, come on and receive me and be forgiven, and I'll become your Lord and God, I came. And when that someone asked me the other day, how often does God come? I don't know. For me, he came at least 3 times, and the third time was it. But I can't tell you he'll do that for you. He may only come once. May the grace of God touch your heart at this particular moment. And you come to know Jesus, the power of God. So anyone here need to come to Christ this morning? You know what, as a pastor, you tell people, bow their head, close their eyes. If you don't know Christ, lift up your hand, I'll pray for you. But you know what, I'm gonna say this morning, I'm going to do it like Jesus did. Come follow me. You got to do that publicly. You got to do that openly before all of man. And you as Christians in here, you follow him every day. You do that every day. You're not ashamed of him. You love him. And he loves you. And you tell this message to everybody you can tell it to. Yes, God is love. Yes, God loves you with all of his heart. He's proved that to you. He's lavished his love upon you with Jesus Christ. He's proved that to you. And what do? We live our lives sometimes like we don't even know him. We live our lives like he's the last one to go to. Oh, we live our lives like, well, that church, I'll do that on Sunday, but not on Monday, not on Tuesday, not on Wednesday, all through the week. Let me tell you something about transformation. When God transformed you, you're a new creation. You're not just new on Sunday. You're new every day of the week in Christ Jesus. He has changed you. And you have a story to tell. You have a story to tell. I have been invited to the wedding banquet, and I will be there. I've got my reservation. Do you? So let's make it this morning. Let's come to Christ. Lance, you want to play something, and let's have ministry here this morning.
I want to see you. Open the eyes of my heart, Lord. Open the eyes of my heart. I want to see you. I want to see shining in the light of your glory. Pour out your power and love as we sing holy, holy, holy. Open the eyes of my heart, Lord. Open the eyes of my heart. I want to see you. I want to see you. Open the eyes of my heart, Lord. Open the eyes of my heart. I want to see. I want to see you, to see you high and lifted up, shining in the light of your glory. Pour out your power and love as we sing holy, holy, holy. See high lifted up, shining in the light of your glory. Pour out your power and love as we sing holy, holy, holy. Open the eyes of my heart.
Folks, there's a time in our lives when maybe we lived a life where we come to know Christ early on and then we stray, and that happens to all of us. And Buck has come this morning and said, you know what? I want to rededicate my life to the Lord.
Amen.
I want to get closer. You know what? We all, that's what we do sometimes. We all have that capacity. Why do we stray away from the one that loves us so much? But we do sometimes. And we need the Lord's Spirit to come to us and speak to our hearts and draw us back in. And that is what he's doing this morning. So for all you Christians in here, you ought to be shouting hallelujah, because you know one day you're going to heaven. Right? Hallelujah. But if you don't know Christ Jesus, you know what you're waiting on? If you don't know Christ Jesus, you're waiting on his judgment. And it'll be too late. So, you know, it's time to get right with God. All of us, we're his church, we're his bride. So we ought to prepare ourselves through the reading of the Word, through the study of the Word, through the changing of the Word. In our lives, we all apply it. We all live that way. So, Lord, be we. I know wherever you go today, God we. Because you claim you're Christian. So, God we. Share the Word. The world needs it. That's what a broken world needs, is the Word of God. May God bless you. May God keep you. Amen.